our young democracy. In ANC, we were witnesses to the defining moments of Philippine history that influenced the world.
Leaders, we don't shy away from difficult conversations.
ANC Leadership Series.
We don't just tell stories, we tell you why they matter. We sift through the noise and arm you with facts.
We report about disruption and how the latest technology and innovation have changed the way we live.
We told stories about crisis, but also about opportunities that came with it.
It's the Philippines.
And we are ANC.
The views and opinions expressed in the following program do not necessarily reflect the policies and position of this network.
Good morning, I'm Christian Esguera, and this is Matters of Fact. Here are today's headlines. The Philippine government's task force against communist armed conflict seeks to disqualify leftist lawmakers from future elections. COVID-19 infections in the Philippines now close to 433,000 with over 1,000 new cases. Malacanang urges local telco firms to submit progress reports after President Rodrigo Duterte gave them until this December to improve their services. And Philippine Chief Justice Diosdado Peralta will step down a year earlier than his mandatory retirement. Progressive Philippine House lawmakers fight back after President Rodrigo Duterte labeled them as legal fronts of communist rebels. They say Duterte's move is an attempt to silence the opposition and a diversionary tactic to hide the government's incompetence. Adrian Ayalin reports.
Progressive lawmakers from the Makabayan Bloc once again on the receiving end of President Duterte's tirades. This time around, Duterte directly linked the group to the National Democratic Front, the political wing of the Communist Party of the Philippines. Makabayan lawmakers have repeatedly said they are not communists. For the Makabayan Bloc, it's nothing but a diversionary tactic of the president amid government's supposed ineptitude in responding to the COVID-19 pandemic and the recent typhoons.
Itong lahat, sa tingin namin ay pagtatakip lamang, no, sa incompetence, no, at sa malubhang problema pa rin sa ating bayan ngayon. At pilit kaming pinipilayan, no, to silence us, especially in our active role, no, bilang mga mambabatas sa loob ng Kongreso.
The grieving bayan muna Representative Eufemia Culiamat, whose daughter Jevelyn died in an encounter between the NPA and the military, was also not spared by the president.
Delikado kayong mamatay kayo sa masama kayo dyan. O kita mo yung kay Culiamat. 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 Oo. Di anak niya mismo, babae pa. Sigurado patay yan. Babae, laban mo sa sundalo, patay. Sigurado.
Siya nga ay medic. Kaya tingin ko ay huwag gamitin ito ng sundalo at igalang natin yung at irespeto natin yung katahimikan ng pamilya ni Representative Culiamat sa ngayong panahon na sila ay nagdadalamhati.
During the Senate's latest hearing on red tagging, Culiamat issued this clarification.
Nilinawin ko lamang, walang kinalaman ang bayan muna sa naging desisyon ng aking anak. Hindi niya siya maaaring gamiting ebidensya para tarasaligtagin ng aming organisasyon pagkat personal niyang desisyon ang kanyang sinusunod. Hindi sa akin, lalo't hindi sa bayan muna.
The Commission on Human Rights reiterated their call against red tagging, which puts the lives of those who are not involved in the armed struggle at risk. The CHR has also received the complaint of Culiamat for the supposed desecration of her daughter's remains in a picture with soldiers after the encounter.
There must be a distinction in the treatment of people who have joined the political arena and are not taking up arms against the government. We would like to caution the government against making sweeping generalizations because it endangers lives.
The military said in a statement that the photo was taken for documentation purposes required after every encounter, and it was not meant to desecrate the dead. Human rights organization Karapatan, as well as relatives of those allegedly killed by the police and the military, are challenging the president to put an end to red tagging activities by the government.
If President Duterte is really serious and alam mo matapang siya, bakit hindi niya sabihin kung sino yung mga corrupt na congressman sa totoo lang, di ba? I mean, kung kaya niyang sabihin na itong mga makabayang congressman ay mga front organization ng communist movement, bakit hindi niya kayang sabihin kung sino yung mga corrupt na congressman ngayon na nasa listahan niya?
Duterte has had a love-hate relationship with the communist movement. In 2017, the president proclaimed the NPA along with the CPP as terrorist organizations. A year later, he credited the NPA for helping him win the presidential polls.
Dili nako maabot ang akong naabtan rong kung wala ko tabangi sa taong Davao, apil na ang NPA.
For the Makabayan Bloc, the continued beating they get from the Duterte administration is yet another attempt to silence the opposition with the 2022 elections approaching.
Yun ang isang implication diyan, no? Pilayan, no? Ang opposition maliban doon sa pagpapatahimik sa amin, no? Bilang mga fiscalizers.
Malacañang reiterates its call for the progressive lawmakers to denounce the use of arms by the communist movement. But the palace clarifies, government will not file sedition cases as it admits communism per se is not a crime. Adrian Ayalin, ABS-CBN News.
From red baiting to electoral disqualification, the Philippine government's anti-communist insurgency task force ramps up its attacks against leftist House lawmakers as it seeks to disqualify them from future elections. National Security Advisor Hermogenes Esperon Jr. says the task force is confident there is enough evidence to bar the bloc from running for public office again. Esperon adds the lawmakers' refusal to condemn the communist movement's actions against the government only strengthens their resolve to have them disqualified. The Makabayan Bloc is composed of the Bayan Muna, the Alliance of Concerned Teachers, Gabriela, and the Kabataan Partidist groups. Now, speaking of elections, Senate President Vicente Soto III has confirmed a provision has been inserted in next year's budget to allow the Commission on Elections to waive tests and certification on equipment for the 2022 automated elections. For his take on this issue, we now have with us election lawyer Emil Marañon III. Good morning, Attorney Marañon, and thank you for joining us on the program again.
Good morning, Christian, at saka good morning po dun sa lahat ng nakikinig ng iyong programa po.
Okay, before we talk about this big revelation of yours regarding the supposed effort at the Senate to insert that very questionable provision in the General Appropriations Act, I'd like to get your thoughts regarding this push coming from the government's task force against the communist insurgency to have members of the Makabayan Bloc banned or prohibited from participating in the next elections. Of course, they're citing their supposed links to the underground movement, in particular the New People's Army. Number one, what do you think of this effort in the context of the bigger effort by the government to red bait this so-called leftist organizations or lawmakers?
Okay. Well, on my part, when we talk about disqualification or cancellation of registration of a registered party's organization, we have to go back to the basic law, which is Republic Act 7941 or the Party List System Act. One thing that we have to note is links to communism or even adhering to the communist principle is not actually a ground for cancellation or even disqualification of any candidate for the party list election. So what ang ground po actually, if you read the law, is the moment when you advocate for violence or unlawful means to achieve the goal of the party list organization. That is the ground for disqualification, but communism per se is not a ground. We have to remember that the basic reason or spirit of the Party List System Act is to actually give representation to the marginalized and underrepresented. And when we say marginalized and underrepresented, kasama po doon yung mga marginalized principle or marginalized na sangay ng ideolohiya. So it means that precisely the Party List System Act is actually is there to actually accommodate this minority or marginalized ideologies for.
And to also encourage them to participate in the parliamentary struggle instead of seeking those reforms, those advocacies through armed struggle. So I think that's part of the spirit of the party list law as embraced by the Constitutional Commission, which drafted the 1987 constitution. But in this case, for example, the fact that certain government officials are citing the refusal of members of the Makabayan Bloc to condemn the armed struggle of the New People's Army. Is this a ground for to have them disqualified in the first place?
Well, unang-una po, hindi doesn't mean naman na kung hindi mo i-condemn na you're already part of that organization or you're actually advocating for whatever ideology yung hindi kino-condemn, di ba? So we have to take note po that I think the Office of the Solicitor General, to my knowledge, has pending cases against the Gabriela and other progressive parties organizations po. And these are pending before the Commission on Elections. So at the end of the day, it will be the COMELEC which will decide on the basis of Republic Act 7941 or the Party List System Act po. As of now, I think it's premature for both the government and the armed forces to talk about this when there is a pending case before the Commission on Elections.
Okay. Of course, earlier you mentioned that the mere ideology, the communist ideology, whether someone is embracing it, does not necessarily mean that that person is committing something illegal because we don't have the anti-subversion law anymore. So the association affiliation with the Communist Party of the Philippines is not illegal per se. But we now have the anti-terrorism law, which a lot of people are quite concerned as something that might have, for all intents and purposes, resurrected the anti-subversion law. So for instance, if certain members of the Makabayan Bloc are accused of committing any of those crimes under the new anti-terrorism law, could that be a ground to have them disqualified in 2022?
Well, under the Party List System Act, sinasabi doon, the moment you advocate for violence or for any unlawful means to achieve the goal of the party's organization, that would be a ground for the cancellation of their registration. However, these issues is factual. So in other words, there has to be factual proof linking the commission of unlawful or terroristic act doon po sa party list organization. So it has to be established by evidence. Hindi lang yung by mere accusation, it will not be enough to actually cancel the registration of a registered party list organization.
And of course, we're talking here of a final judgment by the court, right? Before that that group can be disqualified, is that correct?
Yes, especially considering...
Or is mere designation by the Anti-Terrorism Council of a group as a terrorist organization, would that be enough to have them disqualified or that group disqualified?
Well, una-una po, we have to they have to prove actual links or commission of unlawful or yung pag-advocate po ng unlawful means. It's not enough po na parang mere designation. Kasi po, unang-una po, in my personal opinion, there has to be a final judgment judging or finding these organizations to be a terrorist group or of the same classification po. Kasi we have to remember that COMELEC does not have the legal competence to actually judge whether one is a terrorist or not. So it has to be within a judicial body or with a court before COMELEC can actually decide to disqualify a particular organization. In other words, there has to be a final judgment coming from a court before COMELEC can actually disqualify a particular party's organization.
But of course, the National Task Force, Anti-Terrorism Council, composed of cabinet officials, can also argue that that is an option available under the new anti-terrorism law, the power to designate groups or persons as terrorists. And supposedly, the presumption is that they have enough evidence to do that designation. And we know that there's the second option, to have those groups or persons proscribed as terrorists in a court of law, right?
Yes.
So, I mean, you said designation alone should not be enough to have them disqualified. But how about actual prescription by the court?
Well, if there is actually a finding from a court after giving these organizations due process, which means the right to be heard and to actually argue their case, then that would be a different matter. However, it's not...
Attorney Marañon? Okay, I think he's having problems with his signal. We'll try to get him back on the line. In the meantime... COVID-19 cases in the Philippines now nearing 433,000. That's after the health department reported almost 1,300 new infections on Tuesday, raising the total number of active cases to over 25,000. Ilocos Norte accounted for most of the new cases, followed by the city of Manila and Quezon Province. The country's death toll now stands at 8,400, while recoveries are at nearly 399,000. An outbreak of COVID-19 cases at the Philippine House of Representatives. Nearly 100 House lawmakers and employees tested positive for COVID-19 after the lower chamber conducted its first mass testing last month. House Secretary General Mark Mendoza says everyone who tested positive, most of whom showed no symptom, have been ordered to self-isolate. He says the House is coordinating with the Quezon City government for more extensive contact tracing. Lawmakers and employees will undergo regular testing, especially when going inside the plenary hall. Philippine authorities are crafting guidelines for limited in-person classes, which may be allowed in some colleges and universities early next year. Ara Perez tells us more.
Adrian is a first-year medicine student in UST. In his pre-med course, physical therapy and practical activities are done face-to-face. But the pandemic has changed this.
Sa anatomy po talaga, kasi kailangan po mag-dissect ng cadavers. And mahirap po siyang gawin sa online lang. May pictures po na binibigay yung prof, and then papa-assignment, and then kami po yung mag-label. I think the institution should prioritize our health po first. Kasi... mas importante po na healthy po kami.
For students like Adrian, in-person classes can resume if their university passes the protocols set by the Commission on Higher Education and Interagency Task Force on Emerging Infectious Diseases. This will definitely make practical activities easier. CHED Chairman Prospero De Vera, NTF Chief Implementer Carlito Galvez, representatives of the LGU, and other officials inspected Our Lady of Fatima University in Valenzuela City. The university retrofitted its classrooms in case limited face-to-face classes for certain activities will be allowed, including those related to medicine or hotel and restaurant management courses. At the Clinical Simulation Center, only one student will be allowed to work on each bed. The teacher will be at the other side of the glass partition who can give instructions through a monitor. Here at the Business Center, the site for practical exercises of HRM students, every room will be limited to one student. There is also a set number of students allowed in other rooms, like at the robotics and travel simulation centers and the spacious lecture hall.
I'm so happy that the university will impose a no eating policy in the facility and also no smoking. Because when we go around in the different areas, spreader areas are three areas: in shuttle buses, in the smoking area, and also the canteen.
There are some areas which have good ventilation, but others I think we can still improve.
Ched said it is not a requirement but an option for colleges to hold face-to-face classes. Schools that have retrofitted their classrooms will be inspected.
Hindi ibig sabihin that there will be a mass exodus of students going back. We will allow for certain types of programs to go back with the primary consideration of the health of the students, the faculty.
For Secretary Galvez, college students are easier to manage in terms of self-awareness and restrictions.
Unlike sa DepEd, yung pinag-uusapan nga namin kasi pagka nag-open sa DepEd, lahat yan. Hindi katulad dito sa CHED na interdisciplinary.
CHED, with the help of higher education institutions, is crafting guidelines for limited face-to-face classes, expected to be released this month. For those that will pass the inspection of CHED and IATF, simulation and eventually limited face-to-face classes can be done during the second semester, which usually begins in January. Ara Perez, ABS-CBN News.
We now return to our discussion with the election lawyer, Emil Marañon. Thank you for joining us again. It was cut off earlier because of bad signal. Anyway, we were talking about the grounds for disqualification, possibly members of the Makabayan Bloc. You said that designation alone by the Anti-Terrorism Council should not be enough. But how about court prescription, which goes through a process of at least, I think, up to six months?
Well, again, balik tayo doon pa rin po sa provision ng Republic Act 7941, which is the Party List System Act, na sinasabi doon na it's the advocacy po ng violence at saka ng unlawful means to commit the aim of the organization, which will actually cancel the registration of the party list organization. So for example, mere membership without any proof of committing or advocating unlawful or violent acts, hindi po enough yun. So there has to be proof, it has to be established by evidence that the party list organization is actually advocating violence. So hindi ko alam yung actual na process of designation under the Anti-Terrorism Act. But nonetheless, balik lang tayo doon sa provision ng Party List System Act. Because again, party list organizations are governed specifically by the Party List System Act and not by any general law. So again, balik lang tayo doon po sa provision ng batas.
But based on the provision of the party list law, this was in 1995, right? So
Yes, the
idea of advocating for violence, I mean, isn't that quite vague and can be construed in many different ways? For instance, members of the Makabayan Bloc have been repeatedly challenged to condemn the taking up of arms by the New People's Army, the activities by the New People's Army. Their common response is that they won't condemn that because that is an option that many of our countrymen, members of the New People's Army, have decided to take. Is refusal to condemn tantamount to actually advocating for that armed struggle? I mean, logically.
Yes, well, obviously, hindi. Kasi not condemning is different from advocating. Because to advocate is actually a positive act, meaning you're actually promoting or actually advocating. Or ibig sabihin, parang nilalaban mo yung particular act na yon. But not condemning is different. It's actually passive. So what is required by law is a positive act of advocating rather than not advocating. So magkaiba po yun. I think in case of doubt, it should be resolved in favor of allowing this organization to actually be part of the party list election po.
And there has to be clear evidence. For instance, the allegation that perhaps the members of the Makabayan Bloc are actually supporting the underground movement, perhaps using taxpayer money through the resources they get from Congress. I mean, these are allegations, but there has to be clear and concrete evidence, right?
Yes. COMELEC is a quasi-judicial body, and at the end of the day, it will rule on the basis of evidence and not mere allegations. It has to be proven by facts and by established facts and by actual evidence. A mere accusation would not be enough.
Okay. Now let's go to the other issue. I think your tweets started it all, this big revelation about this effort within the Senate. I think by one senator to insert this highly questionable provision in the General Appropriations Act. How serious was this? And first, if I may ask, I won't ask about your source, but how did you learn about this?
Well, there are multiple individuals who actually came about with this text message na kinoconsult sila regarding a particular proposed insertion doon sa General Appropriations Act or sa GAA. As a background sa public is we are actually now in the process of a bicameral conference ng both ng House at saka ng Senate. So pinag-uusapan ng parehong body po yung budget natin for next year.
Kung paano i-reconcile?
Paano i-reconcile yung dalawang versions ng House at saka ng Senate. And there are instances in the past where some insertions or special provisions would be placed by Congress to actually parang qualify yung pagbigay ng budget to a particular agency. Now, in this case, yung budget ng COMELEC, gusto nilang lagyan ng special provision. Ang special provision na ito, parang they're actually giving COMELEC the authority to waive certain safeguards under the Automated Election Act. One of them is, of course, yung hindi na i-require na priorly tested yung technology, among others. So for me, this is a very dangerous proposal, considering the fact that the moment you make an election system less secure and more susceptible to fraud, then this is actually a threat to democracy. Kasi bakit mo naman gagawing less secure yung election system natin? Because this could be a premise to a massive fraud in the next election if you allow this.
And of course, the safeguards were placed there in the automated elections law, precisely to protect against or to guard against possible fraud, right? But if I may ask,
exactly.
were you able to identify the senator who actually made that proposal? I won't ask you to name that senator.
Well, basically, if you read through the lines, ang proposal is to actually propose a new system, new election system. And I think it's not easy for anyone to check kung sino among the senators are aggressive in actually pushing for a new system and to abandon the technology of Smartmatic. So I don't want to name names. Because wala naman akong proof na it actually a particular senator yung naglalabi for this. But ang sigurado po is it was confirmed by the Senate President himself that there's actually an actual move or in fact actual insertion regarding this special provision. So, dapat po bantayan ng taong bayan ito because this is actually a threat to the integrity of the upcoming elections.
Yeah, actually, if I may share this, I spoke with one senator and I asked about that senator who actually made that, who had made that proposal. And that senator said within their group, they know who that senator was. But of course, they didn't want to identify that senator in public. And then I was surprised when I was looking at the comments coming from different senators, basically condemning that. I think the name that that was mentioned in my conversation was among those senators who actually publicly condemned that proposal. So let's be careful with certain hypocrisies here. Again, we won't name that senator, but you can read between the lines. The senators know who among themselves actually made that provision, push. Now, what was the actual provision? What was the wording? If you have any information regarding that, that was
well, the
being pushed. Ano yung actual wording na gusto ipasok?
Well, the actual wording what na pinopropose po is number one, they want COMELEC to actually use an entirely new system. New software, and that COMELEC is actually given the authority to waive or to lift the requirements under the Automated Election Act, including Section 12 of the same law. So Section 12 talk about the requirement na dapat po yung sistema na gagamitin natin in an election has been tested in prior elections. Kasi ayaw po ng batas na maging guinea pig po yung ating election system na ibig sabihin ititest pa lang or gagamitin pa lang for the first time yung isang technology. So sabi doon sa batas natin is dapat tried and tested na po yung automated election system na gagamitin sa ating eleksyon. So nakakabahala po na all of these restrictions, the certifications, yung pag-inspect po ng mga different political parties at saka ng mga election watchdogs, that all of these requirements will be waived by COMELEC. This will be very problematic because as you have mentioned, this can possibly make our election system less secure and therefore susceptible to fraud if we do this. So nakakabahala lang po because ang tanong, bakit mo gagawing less secure yung election system natin? What is the motive behind this? And all of us should be worried and should watch this carefully. Because okay, yung akin lang po, until hindi pa tapos yung BICAM, hindi pa napapasa yung General Appropriations Act, there is still a threat that this provision will be inserted despite the assurances of different senators that they will block this. But I hope our dear senators will be on the lookout on this and huwag natin payagan po na mababoy yung ating election system po.
But is that even allowed by law? Is that even constitutional? You want to insert something in the GAA to, for all intents and purposes, amend a provision of the automated elections law, election law?
Well, if you are going to talk about it from the technical side, then AGAA is technically a law,
yeah,
and it can amend prior laws. However, ako, ang problema ko dito is that any changes in the election system should go through the process of consultations, of studies, yung opinion galing from COMELEC, galing from the teacher. In other words, kailangan po pag-usapan ng maigi ito. The moment you just make an insertion without consultation, then you'll have a problem because hindi mo po nakikita yung whole picture yet nag-i-insert ka ng changes in the election system. Just to give everyone a context, a hybrid system proposal, for example, has been pending for many years in the committee in the House led by Senator Amy Marcos. So hindi maipasa-pasa doon, hindi makausa doon po sa committee level. So why are we making a shortcut and all of a sudden we are making changes in the election system by actually just inserting a sentence in the General Appropriations Act? And we have to take note po that the GAA is supposed to talk about the budget of the government for the next year. Bakit pag-uusapan yung eleksyon doon kung yung budget naman yung pag-uusapan? So I don't think na it will, I think it will be very careless and very dangerous to do this without much thinking, without evidence, without study. So medyo nakakatakot po kung ano yung intention behind this.
And of course, if you're going to be very suspicious about it, logically, you would, someone who is actually looking for or who would want to push a very questionable provision would find the process at the BICAM perhaps much more palatable to do that, because it's done basically usually behind closed doors and people are looking at voluminous documents to reconcile contradicting proposals on the national budget coming from the two houses of Congress. So that would be easier instead of the other option, conducting public hearings before the committee of the on electoral reforms. I mean, makikita mo na mas madaling ilusot doon, di ba? So good thing that you were able to catch this and actually made use of the power of social media, Twitter, right? I think the senators listened because of that tweet.
Yes, and actually yung nga, ang difference sa BICAM than a regular legislative process is that unlike in the regular process, lahat po ng member ng House of Representatives or ng Senate would have to deliberate on the law on three readings on three separate days. In a BICAM setup, ilang tao lang yung andon and then hindi po nakikita ng publiko yung pinag-uusapan doon. So as you've mentioned, any insertion can easily be made na hindi natin alam. So baka mamaya mabibigla lang tayo na pag napasa na yung batas, biglang may makikita kang sentence doon na hindi naman dapat andon, na hindi na daanan ng both bodies. So for me, this is a very dangerous, very sneaky, masyadong traidor yung pagkakagawa nito if in case na maging successful sila, because behind everyone's back, you actually insert a provision which will have a vital effect and can endanger the election system, di ba? Walang consultation, walang prior hearings. This is very sneaky and very dangerous po.
Finally, do you think that politician, that senator should come clean if indeed that senator thinks that that proposal is good for the country or for the elections?
Well, ako unang-una po, our government system is actually founded on transparency. So if you wish, if you are actually fighting or pinaglalaban niyo po na tama yung proposal ninyo, why would you do it like behind everyone's back? Ako, dapat po, in fact, the Senate President and even the senators who knew this would have the actual obligation before the public to disclose kung sino pong senator yung gustong pahinain yung ating election system natin, na who would make our system more susceptible to fraud. So ang tanong dito is sino po yon? So I think the Senate President and our senators would have the legal obligation to disclose this publicly.
Okay. I hope that senator is watching now. Well, thank you very much, Attorney Emil Marañon, for joining us on this program. Thank you.
Maraming salamat po.
Up next, we'll look into possible solutions to EDSA's traffic congestion following the closure of some U-turn slots. Matters of Fact will be right back. Stay with us.
There still is a lot of fear, which is why investors continue to stay on the side.
The expectation is for inflation to pick up a little bit.
Trade this market, take advantage of the strength.
All right, we're back.
Join David Celdran.
We were lucky to have filmed in South America and Europe.
Welcome back to Matters of Fact. Let's take another look at today's headlines. The Philippine government's task force against communist armed conflict seeks to disqualify leftist lawmakers from future elections. COVID-19 infections in the Philippines now close to 433,000 with over 1,000 new cases. Malacañang urges local telco firms to submit progress reports after President Rodrigo Duterte gave them until this month to improve their services. And Philippine Chief Justice Diosdado Peralta will step down a year earlier than his mandatory retirement. Philippine Supreme Court Chief Justice Diosdado Peralta will retire earlier than expected. The High Court spokesman Brian Hosaka confirms Peralta will step down next year on March 27, his 69th birthday. That's 1 year before the court's mandatory retirement age of 70. Peralta was appointed by President Duterte in October 2019 to replace Lucas Bersamin. Peralta started his career in government service in 1987. He was appointed in 2002 to the Sandigan Bayan, where he served as Associate and Presiding Justice until he was appointed to the Supreme Court in 2009. Under Peralta's leadership, the High Court tackled several major cases, including the poll protests of former Senator Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. against Vice President Leni Robredo, and most recently, the petitions against the controversial anti-terrorism law. Peralta's early retirement will allow President Duterte to select at least one more top magistrate before his term ends in 2022. Hackers targeted the online application database of the Office of the Solicitor General. A group identifying itself as the Phantom Troop defaced the Solgen's website and left messages that said, "Stop blackmailing the National Telecommunications Commission and give ABS-CBN provincial authority." The Solgen's website has since been restored. Solicitor General Jose Calida had previously warned NTC officials they would face lawsuits if they grant ABS-CBN a provisional license, allowing the network to operate beyond the expiration of its franchise. The broadcast regulator later declined to issue a provisional authority to ABS-CBN, forcing the network to shut down its free-to-air broadcasts after the House of Representatives rejected its franchise renewal application last July. News overseas now, cracks emerge within the legal team of U.S. President Donald Trump. U.S. Attorney General William Barr says his department has found no evidence of widespread voter fraud alleged by Trump. Last month, Barr told federal prosecutors to pursue investigations to credible allegations of election fraud and warned them to avoid investigations into fanciful or far-fetched claims. Trump's lawyer Rudolph Giuliani, meanwhile, criticizes Barr's stance, insisting there has been no semblance of a Justice Department investigation. Senate Democratic leader Chuck Schumer predicts Barr could soon be on his way out.
In response to Attorney General Bill Barr, I guess he's the next one to be fired, since he now too says there's no fraud. Trump seems to fire anyone in that regard.
Trump has pursued a series of legal challenges to the results of the November 3 election. So far, none have resulted in meaningful gains, with judges rejecting most of the lawsuits. Turkey imposes restrictions to combat the spread of the coronavirus as the country's daily COVID-19 death toll hits a record high for a 9th consecutive day. President Tayyip Erdogan announced the new measures on Monday, introducing a weekday curfew and a full lockdown on weekends. Turkey recorded 190 fatalities on Tuesday, raising its death toll to nearly 14,000. More than 30,000 new infections were also logged, taking its total number of cases to nearly 669,000. Four people were killed, while 15 others were injured after an SUV plowed through a pedestrian area in the southwestern German city of Trier on Tuesday. The driver, a 51-year-old German, was arrested on the scene. The city's chief prosecutor says the man was driving while intoxicated, and there are no indications of a terror motive. The man has been interrogated by police and is set to undergo a psychiatric examination. A doctor has reached a preliminary conclusion that the suspect could be suffering from a mental illness. The Metropolitan Manila Development Authority urged to reconsider its decision to close 7 U-turn slots along EDSA, the Philippine capital's main thoroughfare. That's after the closure of the U-turns, which is part of the Transportation Department's EDSA Busway project, aggravated the traffic congestion on EDSA this holiday season. Joining us now on the line is MMDA spokesperson Celine Pialago. Good morning, ma'am, and thank you for joining us on the program.
morning, sir, and good morning to our viewers and listeners.
Okay, is this something that the MMDA is willing to reconsider or perhaps forego this closure of at least 7 U-turn slots, at least during the holiday season, to ease the traffic?
Well, actually, sir, we have closed at least six U-turn slots along EDSA in order to speed up the travel of buses using the new EDSA busway. In earlier reports, our GM George Garcia already announced that we are reconsidering to open 2 U-turn slots. The first one would be in North Avenue and Congressional. If we push through, sir, with the reopening of this U-turn slot, it won't be like before. So we are looking for a new infrastructure to improve the flow of buses flying EDSA busway, such as elevated road or elevated flyover. So this would be, at the same time, a long-term solution. So for now, if we're talking about reopening it for the sake of Christmas season, we're still looking into that, but we are looking more for a long-term solution, which is to provide an elevated busway, elevated road, elevated flyover. So at least there would be a U-turn slot. At the same time, the travel of the city buses won't be delayed, because if we will reopen those U-turn slots, then we will call it merging traffic. And if it's merging traffic, that would be another choke point. And if this would be another choke point, then this would be another problem. So that's the reason why, sir, we really close those U-turn slots, and we are eyeing to close more U-turn slots before this year ends.
So how many more U-turn slots will you close down before the end of the year?
Well, actually, sir, overall, that's 13. So far, we have closed 6. These U-turn slots were in Trinoma, Quezon City Academy, Bansalangin, Muñoz, Cain, Balintawak. So we will be closing more. That's the long-term program. Because most of the motorists coming from Quezon Avenue, they are really not using the Balintawak Clover Leaf. Instead, they will choose to use the U-turn slot, the first U-turn slot that's still open, which is Biglang Awa U-turn slot. So that adds up also to the congestion in the Balintawak area.
Okay.
So we have monitored 5 points, sir. No? First, private motorists are still not using the rightmost side of EDSA, which is the former or our yellow lane before. Second, there are 3 roads coming in EDSA. Vehicles coming from Balintawak Cloverleaf, coming from NLEX, and coming from Quirino. All of this are merging traffic. So the only solution to this is enforcement. So HPG, MMDA, we're all in this together. HPG already deployed 200 of their men. So that's the second point, sir.
Okay.
Vehicles going to NLEX, they can use the service road instead of going to the Cloverleaf, because the service road is already open. So this is one of the best reminders to our motorists. Fourth, motorists coming from Quezon City, sir, please take the Balintawak Cloverleaf if they will take a U-turn. Don't go straight to Biglang Awa U-turn slot, because it adds up to the volume.
Okay.
And fifth, sir, this motorist, mostly 100,000, no, are using the U-turn slots. So they are using Biglang Awa U-turn slot, the Jesus left, which is the left turning road going to C3, the MCU U-turn slot. So this vehicle occupies not just one lane, they occupy 3 lanes. So if you will see Balintawak, sir, it's emerging traffic from 4 lanes, narrow down to 2, then duluwag ulit, no? So those are the problems that we're seeing. So
okay.
The long-term plan, elevated busway, second, closed all the U-turn slots.
Okay.
So at least there would be no more U-turn slots na pag-aagawan po nila na they will occupy 2 to 3 more lanes.
Okay. Now, was there actually a study conducted by the DOTR, including the MMDA, before this busway system on EDSA was rolled out a few months ago?
Yes, it's a joint effort of the DOTR and MMDA. So DOTR has this project of EDSA busway. We prioritize the commuters, of course, our commuting public. If you will have a chance to ask our commuters, they feel more safe, convenient with our new EDSA busway. Unfortunately, sir, we still need to fine-tune a few things. especially the complaints of the private motorists regarding the U-turn slots.
Yeah, that's true. Well, but my question is, was there a study conducted by the DOTR, would you know?
Yes,
or
yes.
Let's say, was the MMDA consulted regarding how this could affect the overall traffic congestion along EDSA?
Yes, sir. There was a study, and we are conducting simulations regarding this project. In fact, sir, our study shows that if we will not close this U-turn slots and the original volume of EDSA, which is 450,000 daily, will return on the road, there would be a bigger problem. As we speak now, sir, there are just 200 to 200,000 vehicles daily using flying EDSA. Mm. But we're experiencing this kind of traffic already. So according to our study, our simulation, if we will not close this U-turn slots and the 450,000 will come back in EDSA, that would be a bigger chaos. So yeah. That's why we need to close it, provide a long-term U-turn slots, and at least clear all the roads from any obstruction so they have alternate routes, so they have options not to use EDSA.
Yeah, because if you talk with those who are actually using the busway system, that has been that has provided some sort of benefit to them, let's say going to work during this pandemic lockdown. But if you look at the other lanes along EDSA, that's where the problem is. You're talking of private vehicles and other users of the road. So I, again, did you also consider how much impact would that busway system, however good the intention was, on the other lanes and other users of the thoroughfare?
Yes, sir. That's what I just said. No, we had a simulation and tuloy-tuloy po yung study. At we are in coordination with Department of Transportation. And yes, sir, we're considering all types of vehicles flying in EDSA.
Okay.
That's why, sir, reopening the U-turn slots, we are really reconsidering it. No, pero tinitingnan lang muna natin if we will go to the old U-turn slot or we need to provide an infrastructure for which is the elevated busway, para po sir tuloy-tuloy yung bus natin, at the same time, may U-turn po sa ilalim. That's what we're looking at.
Okay, and I think part of the plan would be to fix the infrastructure, because so far there's been a confusion on when to alight, when to get on the bus, right? But of course, you're fixing certain areas in the different stations of the busway system. But how about, let's say, the yellow lane? I think a good number of our motorists are still confused. They're still looking at the old rule that they could not use. They could still not use the yellow lane because the actual paint is still there. And you still have a lot of billboards saying that this is a yellow lane for bus only. I mean, when are you going to fix these things? Because they add to the confusion.
Well, sir, there's still the road marking, which is yellow, no? Pero we already changed the road signs. If you notice, EDSA, bus only po talaga. Napunta na on the left. It's on the whiteboard. And on the right side, we already removed the CC buses. Road sign rather. But for the yellow marking, sir, we're just waiting for the DPWH because there's a plan in EDSA, if you still remember, sir, the road diet project, you know. So kailangan, sir, pag natapos itong EDSA busway, if it's already fixed, okay, wala nang gagawin, no more changes, then that's the time you will apply the road diet to repaint naman all of the road markings. But why, sir, it takes time lang talaga.
Mm. When are you expected to complete the entire project to make the busway system as seamless as possible?
Yes, sir. Definitely. Because in terms of our EDSA busway, first, we need to complete the bucket par years. So we're depending on the Department of Transportation. We need to provide lights in every stops. No? We need to adjust the road markings, the road lines, no? The road paints. And we are putting road boards or road signages, no, for alternate routes. So, unti-unti yan, sir. And so far, we are almost 80% complete. This is just more on fine-tuning, sir, no. At ayusin po lahat yan. We're eyeing before this year end. Kasi, sir, we are starting to get back to normal, eh. So, palapit na ho yung 450,000 na dumadaan sa EDSA daily.
Yung nga, dumadami na.
Challenge if it's not yet done. Yes, sir.
And then, if I may, as a final point, I'd like to share to you a sentiment coming from ordinary people. For instance, my floor director earlier called my attention regarding this, and he wanted me to ask you this. He being a commuter, a user of EDSA regularly, he said, "Nagko-commute po ba kayo? At saka ibang mga officials sa MMDA for you to get a more to get a better feel of the situation instead of the usual simulation."
answer, yes. Me, personally, yes. No, because I just been in Luna, Jemay Kamuni. If my route is just to go to Orense, napaka-accessible naman po ng bus stop dito sa May Kamuning. Then it's much easier than to use my private car. Lalo na po kapag lalimang rush appointment. Yes, sir. I'm not doing it every day. But nagko-commute po ako.
So at least you understand the sentiment of
yes, sir.
Many commuters,
why, sir?
Of many users of EDSA.
Yes, sir. For our commuters, sometimes, sir, I used to talk to few commuters, no? They are loving the idea of EDSA busway because it's as fast as MRT, no? Hindi na to delay kagaya nung dati na wala sa loading area, nakabalagbag yung bus, agawan. No, kasi sir, at least may mga scheme na talaga nakapila sila, no? Although medyo malayo yung lakarin, pero they're loving it more, no?
Yeah.
Kesa po noon, na pag uminit, umaraw, they're just on the right side of EDSA, waiting for the buses, no? Nakipag-agawan sila, siksikan. So, commuter side, sir, medyo nagigets na natin yan, na i-interview natin sila. May mga complaints, hindi naman po mawawala yun. But
okay.
So far, we're getting positive feedback. But for the private motorists naman po, they're probably more on the U-turn slot naman.
Okay.
So, one time, we also simulated, we really checked kung umapit ba talaga na at least 1 hour to 1.5 hours from Quezon Avenue to Balintawak. Talagang umabot po talaga ng 1 hour to 1.5 hours. Hindi po nagsisinungaling yung mga tao. That's why, sir, the 5 points that I just raised, we fix it already. Yung 3 roads coming in EDSA, 3 kalsada po yan, sir.
Kumutu
ka ng EDSA. Balintawak Cloverleaf, galing Quirino, galing NLEX. So, pwinestuhan po yan, stop and go scheme, no? Minamanage po yung traffic dyan. So, kahit pa paano, sir, from 1.5 hours, nagbawasan, naging 45 minutes. But then, malayo pa rin po lang from Quezon Avenue to Balintawak. So, ano po yung nakikita natin problema?
Okay.
Yung next U-turn slot na bukas, pinag-aagawan po ng mga private motors.
Okay.
So, alam naman mo natin, if we're talking about our motorists, hindi yan pipila sa U-turn slot. Makikipag-agawan po yan. Pag nainip sa pila yan, they will occupy another lane.
Okay.
So, kailangan na hong masara yan.
Okay.
At kailangan na rin hong makapag-provide ng elevated busway para hong sa ilalim yung U-turn slot. And
okay.
Hamper na saka hopefully tuloy.
Well, thank you very much, Ms. Celine Pialago, for joining us this morning. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Salamat.
Now in chess, Filipino player Wesley Saw beats world number one Magnus Carlsen of Norway to win the Skilling Open Championship. So he's representing the United States Chess Federation, needed a playoff to beat the Norwegian world champion after the two players split the 4 games in the early stages of the tournament. Saw took home $30,000 for winning the online rapid tournament. And that will do it for the show. I'm Christian Esguera. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of ANC shows online by subscribing to the ANC YouTube channel. Connect with us on Twitter at ANC Alerts or email us at ancfeedback@abs-cbn.com. Catch us again same time tomorrow here on Matters of Fact.